بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. First question I'd like to ask, you know, when we speak about the day of Qiyamah, in fact, someone asked me this question 3 or 4 days ago. Can you direct me to the verse in the Holy Quran which states that Yawm al-Qiyamah is a day? Right. And I told him, sir, do you understand what Yawm al-Qiyamah means, the day of Qiyamah means? So the argument he possibly was having with the people that he was discussing with was the fact that Yawm al-Qiyamah will be like a day that you and I understand. And very many people have this misconception that Yawm al-Qiyamah, using the word Yawm, day of Qiyamah, literally means like a day that you and I have. Morning, right, lunchtime, late afternoon, sunset, and evening. So the way we look at it is that, you know, time of Fajr, like just after dawn, right, you're going to be resurrected from your grave. Right? And then you're going to start people, وَهُمْ مِنْ غَلَبِهِمْ وَهُمْ مِنْ كُلِّ هَدَبِي يَنْسِلُونَ, and you'll all be start gathering and so on there. By about 10 o'clock, you know, you'll all be gathered in Yawm al-Mahshar, the day of, you know, gathering day, right? And some say it's in Arafah, some say it is in Sham, right? And the difference of opinion, right? And 12 o'clock, 11, 12 o'clock there, you know, it'd be nice and hot and whatever it is there. By 11, 12, the shafa'ah will start and people will be looking for the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. By Zohar time, you know, that all that will be sorted out, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Shafi'ah, Yawm al-Qiyamah. And from Zohar right to Asr, you know, shafa'ah intercession will take place. People, hisab, kitab will all get sorted out there. People going to hell will be going. By Asr coming close to Maghrib there, like all of us going to enter into paradise there. Bi ghayri hisab, mashallah, it's all over. Really? Right? The way we have this misconception of Qiyamah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Holy Quran, خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ فِي سِتَّةِ أَيَّامٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the heavens and the earth in 6 days. Now it's not like the Christian and Judaic concept that God created the world in 6 days, on the 7th day he rested. It doesn't work like that. Days here does not mean Yawm, the way you and I understand it, of a 24-hour time cycle. Yawm here, in this sense, it could mean in 6 stages or 6 processes of evolution. What do we call evolution? Not down here of evolution, but 6 phases of evolution and 6 processes, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put that. In terms of a time frame, we can't put a real time frame to it. Right? It could have been, you know, the 1 stage to the next stage, from 3rd stage to the 4th stage, 4th stage to the 5th stage, could have been millions, billions of years. And if you look at, you know, the various current theories in terms of the creation of the universe through the Big Bang theory, and some call it the expanding universe theory, and then you have the string theory, then you have the parallel universe theory, you know, the quantum theory, and so on. You have so many theories about the creation of the heavens and the earth. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about it in the Holy Quran, which we will discuss at a later stage, in terms of the creation of the heavens and the earth. But at best, what we can say that if he said that ayyam does not necessarily mean 6 days as you and I counted, number one. Number two, there is a hadith in Sahih Muslim, which has been disputed by scholars of hadith, that it is narrated by Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and they regard it as an Israeliyat from the Israeli, you know, traditions that he got this. Right? He said that certain things were created on Sunday, and certain things were created on Monday, and Tuesday, Wednesday, etc., etc. Some of the scholars disputed because they say that he may have learned it from the Israelite and he may have mentioned it without having mentioned that it is from the Israeli traditions. But having said that, it's not out of the pale of understanding that this could have taken place, not in terms of the days that you and I know, but in terms of the progress of creation, etc., etc. It was different. Is what is interesting that in terms of the days and, you know, the days and the nights, Yawm al-Sabt, Saturday, the day of the Sabbath, right, is the holiest day for the Jews. And Yawm al-Ahad, Sunday, is the holiest day for the Christians. And for us is Yawm al-Jum'ah. Now Yawm al-Jum'ah is the Friday, 5th day of the week. No, it's the 6th day of the week. Now you already know that. Yeah, but how many people regard Friday as the 5th day, 6th day of the week? Everyone regards Friday as the 5th day of the week. Okay? You understand? So Friday is the 6th day of the week, right? And Yawm al-Sabt, it actually means 6th. Wahid, Ithnan, Thalata, Arba, Khamsa, Sitta, Sab'a, Thamaniya, Arba. The 6th day, Sabt. Yawm is the day of Sabbath, right? And Yawm al-Ahad is Sunday. Be that as it may, these 3 are the holy days, which means that previous to the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam announcing his nubuwwah, the holiest day was Yawm al-Sabt, Saturday, for the Jews, and the holiest day for the Christians was Sunday. So the value and the significance of Yawm al-Jum'ah was not available for anybody. And the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam spoke about the significance of the day of Jum'ah in Sunan Abu Dawud and so on. He said it is a very blessed day. For one reason, he speaks about the fact that on Friday, in the cosmic realm, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. So it is the day of the Mawlid, or the day of the birth of Sayyidina Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. And Adam alayhi salatu wasalam requested from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to perfect his form, so to speak, there before Salatul Maghrib. Meaning by Salatul Asr, right, you know, he wished that, you know what, his entire form must be created. Now Quran speaks about the creation of Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, because Adam alayhi salatu wasalam is body, mind and soul. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about his creation, and according to the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the cosmic realm, the day of the birth of Adam alayhi salatu wasalam was on Friday. But that doesn't mean Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala started in the morning, right? And then, you know, by the afternoon day, he finished up. The Quran speaks about that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about it in detail. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the physical creation of Adam alayhi salatu wasalam in great detail. فَإِذَا سَوَّيْتُ. Right? And when we fashioned him, يَا أَيُّهَا الْإِنسَانِ مَا غَرَّكَ بِرَبِّكَ الْكَرِيمِ الَّذِي خَلَقَكَ, who created you, فَسَوَّاكَ, and who fashioned you, فَعَدَلَكَ, and he gave you due proportion. Which is very, very critical. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has spoken more about the physical creation of the human being, right, as opposed to the spiritual dimension of the human being at that given moment. And why is that important? Because if you look at various other religions, various ideologies and so on, they will tell you that they give no emphasis and no importance whatsoever to the body. The body is merely a vehicle. It's merely a vessel. It's merely a prison. Right? And it has no significance whatsoever. And what happens is that by virtue of the fact that they give no importance to the body whatsoever, and it's purely a tool or a transport, a medium of transport for the soul, which is the essential you, they give no significance to the human body and the realities of the human body as well. So they will tell you, okay, no, this body is not important. Therefore, they burn the body, right? In terms of freeing the soul from the body as a symbolic, you know, freeing of the soul from the body. Why? Because they don't regard the body as being significant. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the body of man, the physicality of man, right, the mental condition of man, the mental state of man, as well as the spiritual state of man are as important. So you can't separate the three. They each have their significant value. Right? And that's a reality. And the mastery of the human body is something that is neglected in various other ideologies, number one. If it's neglected from the perspective of physicality, it's neglected also from the perspective of its importance, right? As a human being, right, you have certain things which make you human. One is human desires, right? One is you're being differentiated into male and female, right? And the fact that being male and female is not only physiological, but it is also mental, right? And there are subtle differences between the brains of men and the brains of females. Now, what makes you male and what makes you female? Your chromosome and your physicality, right? Now, why is this important? Why I'm putting this point across for you is you need to really understand this, because this is critical importance to the day of Qiyamah. That's why I'm discussing this in detail for you. Your physicality is as important, because if you are male, you're going to experience the world differently. And if you are female, you're going to experience the world differently. Are your souls the same? Every person has individual soul, but the soul is essentially the same. Your five senses are all the same? Okay, I know women lack common sense. Your senses are the same. Your means of interacting with the world are essentially the same. But what distinguishes you into male and female? Men's experiences and women's experiences are different. Men's minds are more analytical. Women tend to be a little bit more emotional. Women have a thicker conduit, you know, a pipe between the I think it's called corpus callosum, that is thicker between women, so women can multitask. They can use both sides of their brain at the same time, right? Whereas men generally use one hemisphere of the brain, and they can't necessarily multitask, right? There are certain things. And in terms of those slight, subtle differences in the brain, and in terms of physiology and genetics and so on, there, right? Stupid example, but it's a reality, right? The libido in men and women differs, right? Number one. Number two is that in terms of your reproductive system, right? Men don't have the same system as women do. Right? Women go through a period of menstruation, menstrual cycles. Men don't have those things. It affects their moods. Right? It affects the condition of their mind. They go through menopause, etc., etc., etc. So physiologically as well, it makes you different, and your experience of life depends a great deal on your physiology. Did you understand that? Now that's very critical for you to understand. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling you here that the creation of Adam alayhi salam, which took place on Friday, was a very, very significant occasion. Therefore, you celebrate it and you observe it by virtue of the fact that you have a congregational prayer on Yawmul Jum'ah. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stated that there is a very auspicious moment, right, on the day of Jum'ah. And if you find that moment, then engage in that moment in the time of, in terms of ibadah. Right, and there are salawat and so on that you must recite, you know, Allahu salli ala Muhammad Nabi Ummi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim and so on, you know, between Asr and Maghrib and so on. And Sayyidatu Nisa'i Ahli Jannah, Fatima al-Zahra binti Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was noted to have expended a lot of time between Asr and Maghrib in ibadah, which gave you an idea that before Asr was where the completion of the physical form, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala breathed into Adam alayhi salatu wasalam of his spirit. And Quran says, فَإِذَا سَوَيْتُ أَنْ وَعَيْفَشْنِمْ وَنَفَخْتُ فِيهِ مِنْ رُوحَ أَنْ breathed into Adam alayhi salatu wasalam of my spirit. Now, two things come out of it. One is that don't get this anthropomorphic misconception there, that there's the mold of Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, and Allah went inside there, and the soul was created. This is called idafatu tashrif. I've mentioned this to you before. It is just a sign of attributing honor to the process of the soul being connected with the body. Right? And because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, this body is an important masterpiece of mine, you respect it. But its true glory is to be found in the soul. And when you have the union between body and soul, it is when you call yourself human. And this is where the connection is. And this is why I always say, we Muslims say, I am, therefore I think. You know René Descartes, I would presume? René Descartes said, I think, therefore I am. So he attributed his being to the fact that he has a brain and he can think and he has consciousness, therefore he believes he exists. We, on the other hand, believe that we've been brought into existence by Allah, I am. And what is the I am? It is the ruh that is in you, which you identify as being yourself. Your ruh is neither male nor female. You yourself are neither inside you, you are neither male nor female. You just identify in terms of your physiology that you are male or you are female. You understand? Unless there are a few Eves who want to be Steves, yeah, I'm not too sure. Right? Or Adams who want to be Madams, I'm not too sure. We're talking about the creation of the father of humanity. Right? But that's what it is. On the day of Qiyamah, right? And this is interesting. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in previous nations, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala turned certain human beings into pigs and monkeys. Now what happened to their souls? I don't know what happened to the souls, you're asking me. Well, you know, they say some human beings are trapped in animals' bodies. You know, you've heard of those stories then. Right? So this is one of the occasions when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala turned them into monkeys and swine. Quran speaks about that there. And can you imagine there that you knew all along that you are human and you identified as human, and all of a sudden you see yourself being morphed into this type of thing. Quran also speaks about, if I remember correctly, about those people that, I think it was Sayyidina Daniel alayhi salatu wasalam, one of the other prophets of Allah, right? He was going past a village and he saw these people who were literally like zombies. You know the concept of zombies? They were literally zombies. So you have these various stages of being in, you know, almost in like limbo in terms of your creation. Now, why this is important as well is that there's a period of time in your life, right, when you end up being a clot of blood, nutfa, right, and you become a zygote in the womb of the mother, right, for about 3 months or so. I think it's under 12 weeks, about 12 weeks or so. For 12 weeks, you are just a fetus. Although the heart beats, and although there is formation of the body and whatever it is there, the soul has not been breathed into you. Important. So for that period of time, that is why the fuqaha of the opinion that as long as the soul has not been breathed, and the Quran has, the Prophet gave you an indication that it's about 12 weeks or so, right? And he says that within that period there, if for any genuine medical reason, in terms of emergency, whatever it is there, the fetus needs to be aborted, it may be done under very extreme circumstances within that period because the soul has not been breathed into it. Why this is important is that as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about the creation of the human archetype, Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, that entire process which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about, which took place in Jannah, takes place in the womb of the mother. You being fashioned, right? If I'm not mistaken, by the time that fetus grows to about 8 weeks or so, it's already a fully formed baby. And that's only what I can think of. The brain is already, you know, already functioning and so on. The brain is developing, and the heart is already beating and whatever it is there. I think the lungs develop the last towards the, in the last 30 weeks or so, the lungs develop. But in that period of time, that's a fully emergent. But till 12 weeks, till 12 weeks is still a fetus. After that, the soul is breathed into it. And then it becomes a fully functional human being. Now that is why, if you were here for 2-3 Jumas ago, the question was asked to Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and he was asked by a non-Muslim king. He said, if the Quran is true, then prove this to me. He said, what is that which is being held as a prisoner, created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and is held as a prisoner, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created it, but has given it no permission to breathe, yet it lives. It is the fetus in the mother of the, in the womb of the mother, right? It is imprisoned in the mother's womb, right? It's not permitted to breathe, yet it lives. Do you understand? So, point was, I want you to pay attention to this point, that the archetype of creation, Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, your own creation in the womb of your mother, and your own rather evolution in the womb of your mother, right, almost mimics, right, Adam alayhi salatu wasalam's creation as well as a human archetype. And then after about 12 weeks or so, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends out an angel there who then breathes life into you, right? And then he writes 4 things on your forehead: your life, right, how you'll spend it, right, your provisions, right, and whether you'll be blessed or whether you'll be shaqi. Shaqi meaning you'll be wretched, meaning will you be lucky or unlucky? I'm just putting it very crudely. These are the 4 things that are written to you. The Holy Prophet stated, and this is very, very important, he said, these things are written, now don't think now, you know what is written there on your forehead, where you're looking for, right? If you remove your wrinkle marks in any way by Botox and whatever it is there. Now I'm not looking at you. Right? That doesn't mean your takdir is going to be wiped out by any way. You can't change that, okay? You may change the wrinkle line, but you're not going to change your takdir. Right? The angel is appointed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to fulfill this program, and your entire thing is put onto your tablet. Where in the tablet? Well, I count you the people of tariqah, it's here. Right? The people who are into tariqah, they will know, you know, this latifa, the spiritual center here, and basically that's your projection. You know, your projector, where your record is played out, so to speak. What did I say? Right? He, meaning the extent of his duration of his life, right? The provisions, right? His risk. And how his life and how he spent it there, and his risk, provisions, right? What did I say? And whether he'd be blessed or wretched. Yeah. 4. That's it?
No, you said the life. Mm-hmm. And how he will spend it.
How he will spend it. That's 2. Yeah, yeah.
How long will he live?
Yeah. Meaning your duration of your life, right? How the life will be spent, yeah. Right? And his provisions, or like how he acquire his provisions. The last one is whether he'll be shaqi or sa'id. Okay, or kama qala alayhi salatu wasalam, right? I'm just giving you a gist of the hadith of the Prophet. It's in Sahih Muslim, if anyone wants to look it up. Right? And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I swear by the one whose hand is my soul, a person continues to do good deeds until the distance between him and the doors of Jannah are one span length. You know, it's an arm's length away. And that which has been decreed for him overtakes him. And then he starts to do those deeds there with the, which are the people of the fire of hell. And he ends up being from one of the inhabitants of hell. And he said there is a person who continues to do evil deeds until the distance between him and the doors of hell are literally, he's an arm's length away from it. Until that which has been decreed for him, right, comes into play. And then he starts engaging in actions which will benefit him, and he ends up from being the people of paradise. Important point to learn here. If you regard yourself as having achieved enough in your life in terms of good deeds, what the Prophet of Allah is telling you here, you have no option but to continue working till your last breath, because up until your last breath, you have no guarantee whether you'll end up from amongst the wretched or from amongst the blessed. At the same time, if you've lived a life of evil, then don't lose hope in your salvation, because you have no guarantee of your being eternally damned until your last moment, wherein your whatever has been decreed for you will come through and you will end up being from amongst those people of good. What it teaches you here is that those people who feel that, you know what, the people who are fatalistic, nihilistic in their views there, well, what is the purpose of life? Everything has been decreed for us, why live everything? No problem. Don't take it in terms of actions, good and evil deeds, and performing actions. Take it in every perspective. And this is the problem. Our people want to look at it in terms of the ultimate reality. The nihilistic view and so on there. What is this world about? There's nothing there. Everything has been decreed. So if I know I'm already going to be one of them, do you know? The Prophet of Allah said,